Welcome to the Ministry of Living on the Edge with Chip Ingram. We trust that the upcoming message will inspire, encourage, and motivate you to apply what you learn as you live out your faith in Christ at home and at work each day. At the end of the message, you'll find information on how to contact Living on the Edge or obtain additional resources. Now, here's Chip.
I've got a little word association game I'd like to play with you very briefly. Tell me what these words have in common. Atkins, South Beach, low carb, high carb, high protein, Jenny Craig, Weight Watchers. Are we there? It's diets, right? It's what you put in your body. You know, if someone has said, you are and we are what we eat. And we know it's true physically. I mean, it's absolutely scientifically proven. If you want to change your cholesterol, you got to change your diet. If you want to change your body, if you want to lose weight, I mean, if you want your heart, your body, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, to change, you have to change, and I have to change what I put in my mouth. But often what we forget, it is just as true psychologically as it is physically. University of Tennessee did a study, Dr. Jack Hadkins, and it was a 12-year study trying to measure in some way the impact of what people put into their minds. They had a control group and a non-control group listen to a 5-minute daily radio program every day, and then they tested them. The results were, if there were 4 negative items in the 5-minute radio program, the listeners were, 1, more depressed, 2, believed the world was a negative place to live, 3, were less likely to help others, and 4, began to believe that what they heard would actually happen to them. Empirical research. 5 minutes, 5 little minutes of listening to 4 negative things impacted them that much. Imagine what, in the average home, 6 to 7 hours of not listening only radio, but 6 to 7 hours a day of TV is doing to the average person in America. You are what you eat. I am what I eat. It is true physically. It is true psychologically. The scripture says, what, Proverbs 23? As a man thinks or as a woman thinks in her heart, so is he. In fact, Ralph Waldo Emerson even gets in. He says, life consists of what a man is thinking about all day. Your life consists merely of what you're thinking about all day. But it's also true spiritually. And Romans 8, you might jot this down, verses 5 to 8, when you have some time or worth looking at, talks about this deliverance we have, the Spirit being in us, the law and the spirit of life, the law, spirit of death. And then after talking about having been delivered by what God has done, it says, for the mind set on the flesh is death. The mind set on the spirit is life and peace. For the mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God, and it is not able even to please God. I'm going to become physically what I put in my body. I'm going to become psychologically and spiritually what I put into my mind. I'd suggest that the most important decision you make and the most important decision your children make and your grandchildren make every single day is this: what they allow to go into their mind. Because you'll notice there's a little graphic on the bottom of your notes. And the idea is wrong thinking leads to negative emotions that leads to unwise behavior that leads to devastating consequences. Often what happens in our lives when we want to change, we usually start at the wrong place. We often start with the behavior. I'm eating too much. I'm eating too much. I want to stop eating. I wish I was eating. I'm drinking too much. I'm not doing enough of this. And we start with the behavior. And we go through cycles and we can't figure out. Some people get a little smarter and they start with the emotions. Like, why am I feeling this way? I notice that I eat when I feel this way. I notice I have these outbursts of anger when I feel this way. That's still not starting far back enough. You have to start. It all begins with your thinking. Wrong thinking produces negative emotions. Negative emotions will produce behavior that is unwise, and a pattern of unwise behavior. What's the scripture say? If you sow to the flesh, you reap corruption. A man and a woman, don't be deceived, my beloved brethren. I'm going to reap what I sow. By contrast, right thinking produces positive emotions. Positive emotions produce wise behavior, and wise behavior, sowing over time, produce fruitful consequences. We are a product of our thought life. And the point I want to make is change, all lasting change begins with how you think. And the scripture is filled with it. I gave you Romans 8:5-8. Study sometimes Ephesians 4:22-24. Take off the old, have your mind renewed, put on. I mean, it's everywhere. Colossians 3, set your mind on the things that are above, not on the things that are earth. Set your mind where your life is hidden with Christ. Over and over and over and over. Just get out your concordance and look up the word mind, or look up the word metamorphosis or transformation or change, and just watch how it is peppered all through scripture. Change begins with your thinking. And that's why the second practice to go from good to great in God's eyes is to think great thoughts. We are a product of our thinking, our emotions flow from our thoughts, and what we allow to enter our mind is the most important decision we make every day. That's the net-net, that's the summary. Now notice, since we're a product of our thought life, God commands us. I didn't just make this up. He commands us to think great thoughts. And you say, well, where do you get that? Well, follow along, let's look together at Philippians chapter 4, look at verse 8. Finally, brethren, verse 6, don't be anxious for anything. Verse 7, how God's going to work as you learn to pray, give thanks in the peace of God. Verse 8, he says, finally, brethren, whatever is true, that means objectively true, conforms to reality, whatever is honorable, that has the idea of that which is worthy of respect or dignity, whatever is right has the idea of justice or righteousness, whatever is pure, that's the idea of moral purity, free from defilement, whatever is lovely, that has the idea of something that is winsome and attractive and beautiful, or whatever is good, and the idea here is admirable, of good report, worthy of passing on to another. And whatever is of any excellence, and if there is anything worthy of praise, dwell on these things. A great little biblical exercise is to go through and circle all of those words and just do a little mini Bible study on what they mean. And then they can become a little grid for what I allow to come into my mind. Whatever's true. Whatever is lovely, whatever is honorable, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is good repute. And then Paul kind of thinks, you know, in case I left something out, if there is any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, notice what he says, dwell on these things. That's the first command. Then notice the second command is the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, then what do you do? Those are all recepting type words, aren't they? Learned. Received, heard, seen. Take all this data, practice these things, and what's the promise? The God of peace will be with you. You see, when we're anxious, really, you know what anxiety is? Anxiety is just dwelling on something. Anxiety is negative meditation. I mean, some people say, well, I don't know how to meditate on scripture. Well, just try worrying and reverse it. It works, right? I mean, anxiety is, I wonder what's going to happen. I don't know. Well, the economy's going kind of south a little bit, and I've got some money put away over here, and if that doesn't come through, then I might have to come out of retirement, or, you know, I had planning to do with this, and what happened? Well, one of my grandchildren, and if that happens, then they could meet one of those kids at one of those colleges, and I wouldn't have enough money, and I have one of my kids with one of those kids, and then I think I'm hyperventilating, you know? And what do? We take one little thing and we dwell on it and then we pull it apart and then we factor out all the possible negative things that could happen. What happens to your emotions? Tightening of the chest, start to get depressed, little panic attack, depression. See, You are a product and I'm a product of my thinking. And when my thinking begins to go south, my emotions begin to really go in a bad direction. And I'd like to tell you I'm real, you know, real objective and I make all my decisions, you know, just based on good thinking and objective criteria. I got news for you. Most of us make our decisions in an emotional state. And we are swayed by how we're feeling and what we do. And what the Apostle Paul is saying is that in the area of anxiety, come to God and learn to offer it, recognize what's happening. He uses three or four different words for prayer. He says, come in general, give thanksgiving, take the specific issue, get it before the Lord, and the promise is that the God of peace will be with you. And the peace of God will reign in your hearts. And then he says, now let's get rid of that as a lifestyle. Finally, brethren, what I need you to do is I'm going to go back beyond the emotions, beyond the anxiety, beyond the behavior. I'm going to go back to your thinking. So finally, brethren, he gives us six or seven things and then scrapes the Milky Way. Basically, think godly, pure, righteous, honorable, winsome, lovely, God-honoring thoughts. And the promise is what? The God of peace will be with you. The word dwell there, the command is to dwell. Write that word in, will you? It's to dwell. I actually put the word, in Greek it's logizomai. It means to consider, the word dwell. To think on, to reckon, to deduce, to reason, to calculate, to ponder. To dwell means to deliberate upon through protracted analysis and thought. When he says purity, honorable, justice, righteousness, lovely, beauty. He says, I want you to get your mind focused in and with a protracted, energetic, intentional ability, think on these things. Meditate on these things. Analyze these things. It's not casual thinking. It's not passive thinking. It's intentionally focused, protracted thought on what is right, pure, good, lovely, and righteous. Colin Brown's Dictionary of the New Testament of this word says, it's not an unemotional or unphilosophical word. This is not just like an accountant going through. But by contrast, it's the very process of reasoning and deduction that separates good from evil. So it's thinking on what is right and pondering what's right and thinking the implications and like looking at situations and looking what's true and then analyzing in such a way and say, I wonder how that would play out in this relationship. I wonder how that plays out in how God looks at me. I wonder if that over time, it's an analytical dwelling on truth, on God for who he is, on you for who you are, on other people for who they are, looking at the future, the past, circumstances through the lens of truth of God's word. And it's powerful. I mean, it's powerful, powerful. I mean, there's a reason why people paid, do you remember what it was for, what, 30 seconds at the Super Bowl? Huh? How many millions, billions dollars for, what, $2.5 million for 30 seconds, I believe, was the cost. Why would anyone pay that much money to have people's attentions for 30 seconds? I'll tell you why. Because I'll tell you what, whatever they see, whatever they hear, whatever you put in their mind, that's what they go out and buy. It's to influence you. Why do companies spend billions in advertisement? The drug companies recently, I read a statistic, the number of billions in advertisement. Why? Because when something hurts and it's not working and I'm going to say, hey, doc, you know, have you seen that commercial? You know, what about this? You think that would help me? Because it influences. We're a product of our thought life. Let me show you how powerful this is. This is not a made-up story. You know, sometimes you have one of those illustrations that is so over the top, you just think, you know what, this guy, he makes these up. His name is George. In fact, I'll give you his full name because if he ever hears this, because he's heard it once, it'll just encourage him. George Dezindra. I was involved in campus ministry, young Christian. I'm now a couple years old in the Lord, and this campus goes from three or four or five kids. Now we've got about 40, 50, 60, 70 kids, and we're meeting this guy's basement, and we're starting to grow. And you know, I'm really a believer, and I'm walking with God, but I'm also on the basketball team. And some of the believers were really love God, but were very uncool. You kind of know what I mean? They didn't dress cool. They didn't talk cool. Some of the girls were not the prettiest girls on campus. But over here on the basketball team, they were the cool guys. You know, we had the big hats and the platforms and had the full-length leather coat. walking in, you know, hey, what's happening, dude? You know, we were cool. And when I went on Thursday night to Bible study, I loved being around this group. But when I went on road trips and I was with the basketball team, I had to be cool. But I had this bad situation where I would be with the basketball team in the cafeteria, and someone that I'm supposed to love and enjoy and be a good friend and be a Christian, like I treated him on Thursday night, would come up to me, and George would come up to me. And George had a little bit of a lisp. And George, I don't know about you, and you know, God bless those who have hair. God bless those who do not have hair. But when you're like 19 and have no hair, it's not really good in college. And George had already, he had like three strands, you know, going over to the left. And he came from a Slavic background, came over from this country, grew up in a hardcore New York City in a neighborhood. His childhood basically was getting up, walking to school, getting beat up on the way, coming home, getting beat up on the way home. The guy had a self-image that was about that big, more negative, had a little bit of a lisp, had zero confidence. How he ever made it into college, I'll never know. And, hey, Chip. And I'm going, you know what I'm saying? Now, none of you have ever done this because you're spiritual and you love everybody all the time and you can identify with this, but just maybe on a bad day once. And I mean, it was like, good, George. Good. Hey, man, I really got to go, right? This guy is socially, mentally, spiritually, I mean, you know those extra grace required people. You know those people that you see them coming and there's another stairway, you use it. This is one of those where you pretend not to see them, you know, no eye contact. And you say to the person, let's act like we're really talking right now because I do not want to talk to that guy. He was that kind of guy. But there's a guy named Jerry on our campus, a little bit older, came to help out. And Jerry saw something in George. And Jerry allowed him to get involved in an investigative Bible study. George wasn't a Christian, and little by little, George got interested, and he began to investigate the scriptures. And for him, are you ready for a thought? What a thought that someone would love him. What a thought that he mattered to someone, not just someone, but God. What an amazing thought that he had value, not because of what he looked like on the outside, not because of what he had done or hadn't done or what he'd accomplished or how well in school, but just because he was George, he was valued and loved and important. And this message of the grace of God and the gospel of Jesus Christ finally gave birth to the new life in George. And I saw George at the end of the school year, and I headed off and he headed off, and we came back, and I met George about 4 or 5 months later, and without exception, I mean, he was like very different, and he was like cogent in his thinking, and some of the wackiness was sort of gone, and I was trying to figure out what was going on. He went somewhere with Jerry, and I cannot tell you all the details, but he went to some seminar or some conference where someone was teaching about scripture memory, and you know he like went ballistic. And so by about Christmas time, I happened to be talking to George, and he had these 3x5 cards about this thick in his pocket. George had the book of James memorized. George had the book of John memorized. George had the book of Colossians memorized. George was finishing up the book of Matthew. And it was like, hey, George, what are you doing? And it was literally, you know those extreme makeover shows? I mean, it was like, it was like, is this the same guy? And you'd talk with him, and I could make it a long story, and it would really be fun because it is so amazing. But all I can tell you is George ended up on the floor with all the fraternity guys, and he was one of those kind of nerdy type guys that everyone would like to make fun of. George's life changed so much, and George had such wisdom, and God changed him as he continued to memorize the scripture, that soon the fraternity guys, I mean the super cool dudes, guys going out and doing all this stuff, they were lining up at his door because George had this sense of what God was doing. And he was counseling them about their girlfriends and counseling about issues when your parents break up. And pretty soon, and this is gospel truth, about another 6 or 8 months, I remember talking with George, and I was not only not embarrassed, it was like, George, you think like you and I could get a little time? I mean, kind of, you know, just hang time, you and me? Sure, Chip, you know. And I would go and I'd meet with George and I would just ask him questions. And it was like I have never in my life ever seen a transformation in about a 9 to 18 month period of time that revolutionized a man's life. And he was so, can I say this? Beautiful. He was so beautiful on the inside, I no longer saw the features. And I no longer saw the loss of hair. And the little accent became almost sort of attractive and drawing instead of a repellent. George Zinder's life, he became one of the key people in this entire ministry, and he became someone that we wanted to be around. Because he renewed his mind at a level like no one I've ever met. I was teaching that illustration with another passage about 3 years ago, and I got an email. Hi, my name is Zindra, and my husband's name is George. And you can't be that same Chip Ingram from West Liberty State College, can you? Because George was saying that he was involved in a college ministry with some Chip Ingram, but you're on the radio, and well, my husband's a pastor now. And you know what? I can't even type. Dear, I'm the same Chip Ingram. And you got to know, I had no idea what happened to George after graduation. Your husband has inspired me to walk with God, memorize scripture, and take seriously what I put in my mind like no other human being I've ever met. Here's what I want to tell you. Your life can change. All that baggage, all those struggles, all those thoughts, you are a product of your thought life. Wherever you are today is a product of how you have been thinking. And here's the deal. Wherever you're going to be next week, next month, next year, next decade is going to be about how you start thinking right now. And so what I want to do, this is the fun part. I want to give you some very specific ways to learn to think great thoughts, okay? I'm not going to leave you with, oh gosh, I'm going to try real hard, think great thoughts, or I guess I'm going to have to memorize the book of Matthew, James, Colossians. It's a good idea, but I doubt if many of us are going to go there overnight. So what I want to talk with you about is seven areas to cultivate great thinking. And I'm going to touch on them, and then at the end, I'm going to give you a little game plan. I believe it's really, really crucial that we think great thoughts. We need to think great thoughts about God. I've just given you one verse. Now, I will say, for you second milers, if you had a 3x5 card somewhere, you could say, think great thoughts about God. And then while no one's looking, you could write Romans 11, 33. And by the way, I only put 33, but you might want to put all the way to 36 because it's hard to stop. Oh, the depths of the riches, both of the wisdom and the knowledge of God. How unsearchable is God's wisdom and his past beyond finding out. Who has known the mind of God, or who has been his counselor? Who's given anything to God that he should repay him? For by him and for him and through him are all things. What if that was the kind of God you worshiped? What if you thought there was a God who knows all things? His ways are mysterious, they're beyond finding out, and you begin to think a high, accurate view of God. And yes, you can learn it from books like Tozer and but I think first and foremost, the depths and the riches of the wisdom and the knowledge of God. Do you know what wisdom is? Definition of wisdom. Wisdom is God does and brings about the best possible results by the best possible means for the most possible people for the longest possible time. Oh, the depth of the wisdom. Anything you're going through in your life right now, you worship, if you know Jesus personally, you worship a God. If there was an easier, lighter, better way to orchestrate what he's doing in you and through you, he would be doing it that way. The wisdom of God tells you he's bringing the best possible results by the best possible means for the most possible people for the longest possible time. Oh, the wisdom and the knowledge. He knows all things. He knows next week. He knows about Al-Qaeda. He knows the stock market. He knows about your children. He knows about your grandchildren. He understands your singleness. He understands your depression. He understands all the things that are going on inside that no one, the knowledge of God. Oh, the depths. It's beyond finding out. When you begin to think of God like that, how? Through scripture. How? Through great books. And third, how? You might jot this down, through nature. I've learned this from my wife. I am such a highly focused, I almost said driven, but it's such a, sounds so bad, driven person that We lived in California about 5 years before I recognized there's flowers all year round. There's flowers here, there's flowers there, flowers there. I mean, there's flowers everywhere. And I have a wife who looks at the forest and is quiet, and has a wife that can sit in a chair and watch birds, and a wife that we can drive through beautiful country and for 30 minutes not say a word and just absorb. And she taught me to go up to Tahoe and just look at the mountains, and I don't even have to say anything. Just what kind of a God would it be that would make such beauty? What kind of a God who could do anything how he wanted would make red and blue and yellow and violet and 5,000 different kinds of beetles? What kind of a God? What creativity? What love? How winsome could it be when you see the oceans roar and the rocks and the... See, we need to think accurately about God. And you think accurately about God when you get verses on cards that talk about who he really is. And you read through the scripture, you think accurately about God when you take the Tozer books and the Packer books and begin to digest them. And you think accurately about God when you allow nature and the creation. It reveals the heart and who the creator is like, Romans chapter 1. Thinking accurately about God also, I've learned, comes when you worship. I learned from my wife, I actually look at flowers now. I actually at times got to where I would pull off and just stare at the ocean. There's times where I take a walk for non-exercise. It's an amazing adventure. I never dream. Why would you ever walk anyplace if you're not trying to get someplace? That's me. Sometimes it's just good to walk to see and behold the heavens declare the glory of the Lord. And to let it soak in and to let God speak to you and to know that he's a, what? What do you learn from it? That he's a good God, that he's a wise God, that he's a God who knows and understands your hurt and your pain, that he's a God who cares. And if you want to really get a right view of God, just study the life of Jesus. Study the life of Jesus. Study the life of Jesus. Because everything what Jesus say, if you've seen me, you have seen the Father. Second, though, is we need to not only think rightly about God, we need to learn to think rightly about ourselves. Learn to think great thoughts about yourself. And you say, well, what do you mean? I mean, learn to look at yourself the way God looks at you. And here's my key verse, Zephaniah 3:17. The Lord your God is with you. Isn't that comforting? He's with you. Well, if he's with me, what can he do? He is mighty to save. He's powerful. He's with you. And whatever need you have, he has the power and ability to save. Yeah, but would he help someone like me? He will take great delight in you. Would you circle the word delight in your notes? Just to get involved in the... He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Would you put a little squiggly line under rejoice over you? So you need to get an accurate view of God, think great thoughts about God, but you got to think great thoughts about yourself. Do you get up in the morning and with all the things that you're going through, and do you look at the mirror and see all the things that are wrong? I don't mean the physical mirror. I mean the psychological mirror. I mean how you tend to just unconsciously do that self-talk to yourself. Or do you wake up in the morning and do your eyes open up? And what would happen if Zephaniah 3:17 came down? And before, you haven't moved? You haven't prayed, you haven't shaved, you haven't showered. And it was, I'm with you today. I delight in you. Whatever happens today, I'm going to quiet you with my love. I'm mighty to save. The moment you have a need, I will be here. I delight in you. You are valuable. You are precious. I'm going to save your tears in a bottle. I know all your days. I know every hair on your head. You matter so much to me. I sent Jesus, my son, to pay for your sin. You are the object of my affection. Can you imagine what that would do for how you think about yourself and how you live your life if you believe that? You see, we got to think great thoughts about God, about ourselves, and about others. I love the passage in 1 Samuel 16:7. It's the prophet has been told, you know, Jesse, one of his boys, are going to be the next king. And so the prophet goes and he sees this big hulk of a guy and he's good looking and a head taller. And, you know, he thinks, well, I guess this is the guy. And the Lord speaks to him and says, Samuel, do not consider his appearance or the height of his stature. for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at things the way a man looks at things. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. And you might jot down 2 Corinthians 5:16. It's really, you know, 5:17, we kind of know the verse, you know, if any man be in Christ, new creature. 5:16, he says, Paul will say, even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, now we know him thus no longer, and therefore we judge no man according to the flesh. See, I want to learn to look and think about other people the way God thinks about them. And so I have little 3x5 cards because I can't keep things straight, and I write them. And I don't try and memorize them. I used to try and memorize them, and I felt all this pressure. I just read them over, and I end up memorizing them, but it seems, I don't know why, but it just seems a little less legalistic and a little less like I'm, you know, banging myself in the head. I just read them over. Just read them over and enjoy them. And I have a 3x5 card that says, I long to look at people the way that you look at people, Jesus. Not by their outward appearance, status, ability, or wealth, but by their heart. And I just want to practice. I want to get where when I pull up next to a car and it's a really fancy car and the Rolex watch is out the door and I think there's a human being made by God. I know nothing about his life and I'm not going to try and make up little stories about where he's coming from, what he has, where he's been. And when I look at the beat up Pinto on the other side and the guy that has, you know, the four earrings coming down, the tattoo on the sleeveless shirt and the Rastafarian hair, Lord, I don't know what's going on in this man's life, but what I know is that all that I see externally is not how you see him. I want to view him and see him and treat him the way you do. And see, that takes practice because I grew up in the same culture you did and I'm human. So what do? We treat certain people dressed a certain way, a certain way. We think certain thoughts make us, oh, that's a tattoo, know where he's coming from. Oh, those two are holding hands. Well, in that culture, girls do hold hands with girls at that age. There's nothing going on there. We make so many assumptions and we so judge so many people in so many ways. And God says, think great thoughts. Tell you what, think the way I think about people. Man looks at the outward appearance, God looks at the heart. Fourth area to think great thoughts about is your life. You need to think great thoughts about life itself. Notice what Jesus said about life. He gives us a great thought in Luke 9, 23 to 25. He said to them, remember Peter? Peter has just finally got it really right. Who do men say that I am? Some say Elijah, some say this, some say a prophet. Peter, who do you think? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Bang! You win today, Peter. Way to go, you're right. And then he shifts it and he talks about, now that you know who I really am, then he said to them all, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. Why? I mean, do you realize where he's setting the bar? No other priority more important than me. No other person more important than me. No other agenda more important than me. I want you to set aside your dreams, your goals, your life, your money, your puny view of life, and I want you to follow me since you know I'm God and I'm the Messiah and I'm good and I'm wise and I'm all-knowing and I always have your best in mind. I want you to release your life to me in surrender and I want you to follow me wherever I say, even if it sounds crazy. And we're thinking, that sounds really scary. I don't want to do that. But he tells us why. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will save it. In other words, if you try and hang on to it, if you try and control, it's my money, my time, my dreams, God, I'll obey you as long as it's, you know, these two states and at this financial level and doing it this way, and I'm near to these kids, but not. We never get to say that. We make no conditions. If you try to save your life, you will lose it. But if you lose it, I'll do whatever you want me to, Lord. I'll go wherever you want me to, Lord. Think great thoughts about life. Life is not about getting, accumulating, controlling, manipulating, and having my way so that I create a false sense of security and I can project and think that I'm a somebody significant because I have done this and owned this and can do that. Life is about following Jesus and losing my life, but not because I'm dumb, it's because I'm smart. If he's the author of life, then I'm going to lose or surrender my life, and by that I'm going to gain it. And then he gives us the greatest reason. For what good is it for man to gain the whole world and yet forfeit his very self? And don't we see it everywhere? Don't we see all the people? I mean, we're in California, right? And if you're not from California, you can make fun of people from California. And if you've lived here for a while, you can make fun because, you know, you've been here. But I mean, you think, what do people want? They want everything that's in Southern California. I want to look like the people in Hollywood. I want to have the money of the professional players. I want to have this house here and that house there and that kind of car. I want to dress this way. I want people to think this, and boom, boom, boom. The prettiest, smartest, most successful people in the world live in Southern California. A lot of you people from around the states would argue that. But I mean in terms of the image. And yet, you know, they can't stay married for more than 2 weeks. They can't figure out with billions, it seems, and millions of dollars to not put white powder up their nose. They can't, I mean, I read those tabloids, you know. No, take that in context. As I'm going through the grocery line, come on, think great thoughts. But as I go through, you can keep up with the whole world by just, you know, getting milk once a week. And as I do, I just think there's a part of it that, you know, in your flesh, that you're sort of lured, you know, curious. I wonder who she married last week or is with, and they broke up and all, you know. And then there's a part of it with just an ounce of thought where you think about life rightly and you think, isn't it sad? I mean, isn't it really sad that someone that pretty, someone that successful is going through their seventh or eighth partner and, you know, now they're anorexic and they've made all these movies. And you know what? I'm asking God to give me a heart that looks at people the way he does, but more look at life the way he does. Because I'm not immune to wanting to accumulate and impress. I'm not immune to, you know, you can do it in ministry. Want to be significant, want to be successful, want people to like you. You know what? It's all about trying to save your life. Think great thoughts about God. Think great thoughts about yourself. Think great thoughts about others, and think great thoughts about life. As the song says, it's not about me. Fifth, think great thoughts about your future. Jeremiah 29:11 says, "For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." How do you think about the future? So many of us think about the future with fear. Some of us think about the future with anxiety. What's going to happen next? What about the terrorism? What about the economy? What about my kids? What about my grandkids? What about my singleness? What about the big decision I've got to make? And then we think about the future. How do we think about it? We think about, what do I have to do to protect myself from something bad? What would happen if you thought great thoughts about the future? Is God sovereign or not? Is God good or not? Is God all wise or not? If there is a good God that has a good plan for you, and he's all knowing, he's all wise, has the power to deliver it, and orchestrates all things on the face of the earth, you can face the future with confidence. You can face the future with hope. In fact, we're going to talk about it later, but what if you actually, I call it doing the math. What if you extrapolated all the way out to the very worst thing that could happen? You're a Christian, okay? You love God. I mean, there's issues and there's relationships and there's finances, okay? But you really love God. And you know when you get in those thoughts of this could happen, then this could happen, this can happen, and I could get cancer, and then this could happen, and this could happen. Okay, let's just play it out. Worst thing that can happen, you die. You're dead. Dead. You're a Christian. So what happens to you? You immediately go to heaven. Oh, bummer. I mean, that's how Christians live. Oh, bummer. Let's see, I'm with Jesus. There's no pain. I'm reunited with my loved ones. You know, as Prof. Hendricks says, hey, I've started a journey of completion and graduation. I've fallen asleep in the Lord, and I'm going home. I just heard him speak on that. It just gave me such a picture of what the future is like with Jesus. It's like falling asleep. No one's afraid to fall asleep. It's like going home. No one's afraid to go back home. It's like starting on a journey, a graduation. We all like to do that. You know, worst case scenario, your future is the God of the universe sent his son. He died for you, paid the price, rose from the dead. You received him personally. And the worst that can happen is you're going to end up with Jesus forever and ever and ever. But see, we don't think that way, do we? Think great thoughts about the future. You have a hope. that can't be tarnished, that can't be spoiled. You have a God that has a plan. You matter to him. Think great thoughts next about the past. Paul would say in Philippians 3, 13 and 14, brothers, I don't consider myself yet as having laid hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for that which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. Would you underline forgetting what lies behind and then underline I press on? And underneath that, I want you to write a little note that says, I will forget about my past failures. And I will forget about my past successes. You know, there's some believers that have been through a divorce, been abused, or abused someone. I remember the first time in the church where I pastored, and I had a guy that abused a 7-year-old kid. I mean, that's just so, you know, think, and doing counseling with him. And when he got out of prison and came and showed me his card, and I'm a sex offender, and the whole nine yards, tears streaming down his eyes, going, I never wanted to do that, and this is what happened in my life. You know what? Instead of a sex offender, he became a person, a real person, and he found Christ. But you know what hangs over this guy's life? I'm a sex offender. Forgetting what lies behind. What's in your closet? What is it that down deep you spent inordinate amount of energy covering? You know, a divorce, a separation, an abortion, some stealing, some lying. Think great thoughts about your past. Psalm 103, as far as the east is from the west, so far has God taken your sin from you. Isaiah 1, though your sins, though my sins be like scarlet, he'll make them white as wool. Though they be as red as blood, he'll make them white as snow. You're clean. You don't have to do penance. You don't have to feel like a second-class citizen. Put your past behind you. That is not you. You are fresh. You are clean. You are born again. You have been adopted into his family. You have an eternal inheritance. You have the Spirit of God living. You are a son. You are a daughter. You have a future. You're heaven bound, and he loves you. Think those thoughts. Don't be paralyzed by the past. But I would encourage you also, don't think about past successes either. There's a lot of people that, you know what, you've done some significant things spiritually and significant things with your family and some significant things in ministry and in business. You know what? If you don't forget about that, you'll get complacent. You know, I've done this. I don't know how many times in churches I hear this. Well, I've done my time. Well, how old are you? 62? You in good health? Yeah. I'm so good health, I play golf 6 days a week. Oh, man, I'd say that's impacting the kingdom. Oh, man, what are you, different foursome every day? And, you know, guys probably kneeling at whole night. Yeah, Jesus, come into my life, thank you. You know, what we have so bought into, people are thinking, I'm not coming back. He's slamming TV now. He's slamming golf. Hey, I'll play nine with you later. I love to play golf. But do you understand the mentality of what we're doing? We think the goal is that to get so far, stop, and then coast. The reality and the joy of life is not in the attainment, it is in the process. And so many people in their mid-50s, 60s, and 70s, you never, ever will have more to give to God, to the kingdom, to people, to your grandchildren, to your neighbors, or your church than you do right now. And we got people going, well, you know, hey, you know, I did my time. Your time's done when you're done. You know, I don't have first retirement 1-7. Now, You may physically retire, you may rearrange your schedule, but you know something? You're done when you're done. You know, Moses, what if Moses at 79 said, you know, I'm going to be 80 next year, I think I'll bag it. We'd be in trouble. Finally, think great thoughts about challenges. How we think about the difficulties and the adversities that come into our life really shape us. James says some very hard words, but they're said to a group of people that are in a lot worse shape than most of us. First book written in the New Testament. It says to verse 1 of James chapter 1, it's to those scattered abroad. They're Jewish Christians, and they've come to know Christ, and a lot of people are becoming kind of human torches, and persecution has hit. And some people said, you know, I believe Jesus is the Messiah. And their parents said, guess what? You're no longer my son. You're no longer my daughter. And now you don't have an inheritance. You don't have a place to live. And the persecution came and they're spread out and they've lost home. They've lost relationships. They've lost their jobs. They've lost their companies. Everything, they have a broken world. It is not working. It's shattered. Their financial security, their relational security, everything that helps us stay sort of solid is gone. So what would God say to a group of people like that? Consider it. The word is reckon. Think thoughtfully. Ponder. Consider it pure or all joy. What? When you encounter various kinds of trials. The word for various trials there has the idea of those things that come from the outside. Those circumstances, those uncontrollable things. Consider it. Choose, literally, choose to consider it joy when adversity and difficulty comes into your life. And you're thinking, why? Knowing. And the word for knowing here, circle it if you would. It's not an intellectual knowledge. There's two words in the New Testament for knowing. One has to do with knowing by way of experience. The other is an intellectual, you know, 2 + 2 = 4. I know that's true. This is knowing by way of experience. Knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let or allow endurance to have its perfect result, that you may be perfect or mature. I like the version you have right there. Perfect or mature and complete, lacking in nothing. James would say to a group of people who, guess what? In our vernacular, their marriage broke up. They had a grandchild commit suicide. They financially thought everything would be okay, but now, wow, some things really went in a way that, and you're in a situation where you're thinking, I never dreamed I'd be where I am now. I ran into two people in the last week who've been married over 30 years whose mate walked out on them. Broken world experience. How do you respond to that? How do you respond to the inner struggles and the pressures and the sick of being loneliness and wanting a mate and crying out to God and it's not there? Or a problem in a marriage that, you know, God, I know divorce isn't right. I know divorce isn't right. I know that's an option, but man, this stinks. This stinks. Help, help, help. Or working on a business or working on an issue and no matter what happens, it just won't come together. What do? You choose to think about it biblically. What we tend to do is say, well, you know what? I'm like this because what my mom and dad did. Or actually, couldn't be my dad because he left us when I was 2. Or I'm like this because, you know that guy was my boss. I'll tell you what. When they did that, that guy is such a jerk. And we have people who live with a blame, shame, or victim mentality, and it's everybody else's fault. And you know how you think great thoughts about your adversity, your challenge? I choose, because God is in control, I choose to consider this pure or unmitigated joy. A feeling? No, it's a choice. Why? Because what I know is that God, being all-knowing, good, wise, and powerful, what I know for sure is this adversity is going to do something, and this testing is going to produce endurance. Like a weightlifter, you put the weights on, and you start doing the dips. And like a weightlifter, if you keep doing that, guess what's going to happen? Over time, those muscle fibers begin to split. Any of you guys that have lifted weights? And that's why you rest the second day, then it heals. And how's it heal? Stronger. God brings weights into your life sovereignly, lovingly, wisely. Internal weights, relational weights, financial weights, family weights. Painful things into your life. It's a fallen world. He allows them to happen, but he's going to work them for good. But your response, how you think about it, your attitude, will make all the difference. You can either be a victim, whine, complain, substitute, soothe and medicate your pain with unhealthy things. Or you can say, I'm going to make a choice. I choose to consider this all joy because God is going to produce endurance. And endurance does something to a man or a woman. It does something to their character. I'm going to let God use this to make me more and more like his son so that I am perfect, mature, teleos, so I can fulfill the design that God ultimately wants in me. I'm going to become more and more like Jesus through this suffering. Hebrews 5, although he was a son, speaking of Jesus, although he was a son, he learned obedience through the things which he suffered. And we're living in an evangelical community who does everything to avoid suffering, rather than saying it is a part of what happens in a fallen world. And people will see more of Jesus in your life by how you go through suffering, whether it's internal, family, financial, health. They'll see more of Christ in your life by how you go through suffering than your great successes and saying, Jesus did it all. We've got to think accurately, great thoughts about God, ourselves, our future, our past, our challenges, because you're a product of your thought life. How do you get there? Let me give you a little to-go package and we'll wind it up. Has anyone got the idea that possibly memorizing and meditating on Scripture is going to be a part of this deal? And you know what? You don't have to kill yourself on this. You can write them on 3x5 cards. I think the NAS still put out the topical memory system. I started with just 60 verses. And you know, they have, you know, 30 topics. You memorize 2 verses. And then I just started making up topics of my own. And then you just, you know, you do have to review them for 4 or 5 weeks so they won't stick. And then you'll get so many that it'll get a little overwhelming, and some of you get a little arrogant. You get a few hundred verses and you'll think, oh, wow. And then God will bring some humbling things into your life and you'll realize it's not memorizing the verses. I'm sorry, Lord. And, you know, it's knowledge puffs up, love edifies. But then you'll just develop a little system. And as God really speaks to you, you write it down and you memorize it and you use those little times where you're kind of bored. And you will find that God will renew your mind and transform your life. I encourage you to use your drive time. I listen to teaching tapes. I do listen to worship. But sometimes just turn it all off. Be quiet. Think great thoughts. You know, what if you just took these 7 areas? What if you took these 7 areas that I gave you and the single verse that I gave you and you wrote, think great thoughts about God, Romans 11:33, and you wrote it down and you made 7 cards, and in the next couple weeks, you just started in on them and just read them over and begin to think. And then add kind of little thoughts of your own on the back of the card about thinking great thoughts. You know what happened? I'm just telling you, in 10 days, your emotions will start to shift. Why? Because right thinking produces to what? Positive emotions, which leads to wise behavior, which leads to fruitful consequences. Third, is listen to great music. Thinking great thoughts. It's interesting. I'm reading through The Daily Walk. I did it for years and years and years, and then I haven't done it. And Teresa and I thought, you know, let's kind of go back and read through the Daily Walk Bible. And so we're grandparents, so we're thinking like grandparents. So we got a Daily Walk Bible for all of our kids and all their wives and everybody. And so I don't know if they're all doing it, but at least theoretically we can be moving through the Bible together, and it just feels warm and ooey-gooey in this grandfather's heart, you know, just right here, you know. And so it's interesting, though, that I'm reading through Moses, after all the turmoil, and when he wanted the people, the second generation after they blew it, did you notice what happened, what God told him to do? God said, Moses, you know, round one, they didn't do so well. This is a very loose translation of that phrase. But, you know, we need to do better this time. So what I want you to do is I want you, after you review it, put it into a song. And we have the Song of Moses. And in my Bible, you know, it's pretty small print, but I mean, it's 3 or 4 columns. He put the entire history of Israel and the greatness of God and redemption and deliverance and who God is and who we are and what he did and what his promises are. And he put it in a song. I don't think there's anything probably that is an easier way to memorize or to also get good things in your mind by listening to great music. And finally, take those walks in nature and hear God's voice. One of the things that I've done that's been very helpful, I learned this from my wife, was memorizing random scriptures can be very helpful, but I've tried to look inside my heart and my life and my family, and I realize I've got a half a dozen issues, you know. Maybe I've got 12, but I've only learned about 6 or 7 so far, and they're reoccurring. I get overextended. Why? Well, down deep, I want to prove myself. I don't believe God really loves me. Okay. Well, you know, you can just keep being a workaholic, or you can keep pleasing people, and you can just have a quiet time over here and not make the connection. And so what I finally did years ago, I said, you know something? This is the truth I need. And so I wrote down, I feel compelled to please people, to be on the go, to make this happen, because I down deep don't believe I'm significant in your eyes. Period. Stop. And then turn the card over. And then put a Zephaniah 3:17 on the other end. And just take, what are the issues in your life? Is it, you know, temptation with lust? Memorize a verse on that. Is it struggles in a relationship? Is it temptation with the media? But take the area where you struggle, and we all do, and write out your bad thinking and then write stop. In fact, I even made a little stop sign. Mine's very artistic. And then flip it over and put the truth. And what you can train your mind to do, you can train your mind because you read that one, you say stop. When unconsciously those thoughts come because you've been programmed, the stop will come and then God will bring the verse to mind and you can break out of destructive habits. Your life can totally change. Does it take time? Yeah. Does it take work? Yes. Take focus? Absolutely. Take discipline? Mm-hmm. Those are like fruits of the Spirit, you know? Think great thoughts, and you will experience a great God and a great life.
This concludes our teaching. If you'd like to contact Living on the Edge, check us out online at www.lote.org. On behalf of Chip and the entire staff at Living on the Edge, thanks for listening.